Thank you all, and welcome to the 118th annual meeting of membership of the Chicagoland Chamber of Commerce. My name is Kevin Cassidy, and I'm the chairman of the board of directors, and I officially call this meeting to order. It's really wonderful to see Chicago's theater district back in full strength. So let's start by giving a big round of applause to Broadway and Chicago for that very cool performance. Very cool. It's such a pleasure to be able to welcome you all back to our first in-person annual meeting in 2 years. All right, we can cheers for that too. We have an incredibly exciting program ahead, and in a few moments we'll hear from Illinois Governor J.B. Pritzker on the future of our state economy. We'll see a video address from Mayor Lori Lightfoot on our city's business leaders, and we'll welcome Google's President of Global Clients and Agency Solutions, Karen Sauder, to discuss the accomplishment of Chicago's tech sector, and we'll debut the findings of the Chicago Tech Effect, the Chamber's landmark study of the Chicago's innovation economy. But before we dive in, I'd like to take a moment to acknowledge today's sponsors. One of my roles is to talk a little bit about our sponsors, and they've really helped make this a reality today. First, thank you to today's presenting sponsor, AT&T, and my fellow Chamber Executive Committee member and president of AT&T Illinois, as well as AT&T Great Lakes, Eileen Mitchell. Let's take a moment to acknowledge AT&T for their generous support. I'd also like to acknowledge the commitment of our event sponsors for today, including the board members that represent these organizations, BDO and Stephen Ferrara, Google and Rob Biederman, PNC and Shane Print, United Airlines and Dan Lynch. I'd also like to thank today's founding sponsors in Adelman and Mary Lynn Bender and Walgreens and Steven Johnson. So let's do the round of applause one more time for everybody. Well, I can tell you that it's a bold new day. It's been a bold couple years, frankly, but it's a bold new day for the Chamber and its members. Coming out of the pandemic, there's a renewed sense of excitement and momentum behind the organization, meaning the Chamber. And we thank you for your support and helping to drive the Chamber forward on this new and what I'd call innovative path. As the leading independent voice of the business community, the Chicagoland Chamber has been able to complement the tremendous legacy of historic leadership with forward-looking mindset to help the organization and help our members, you folks, stay ahead of the curve. In looking at some of our most recent slate of events, I'd like to highlight a couple things as a way to point that out. It's clear that this is not your, what we call, not your father's chamber. In the past few weeks alone, we've held fascinating conversations with Charlie Bachtel, who's the CEO of Cresco Labs, on the future of cannabis in the Chicagoland area. And I don't know that anyone would have predicted that the Chamber would be talking about cannabis, but we're leaning forward. We did that at the Lincoln Park Zoo in the new Lion House. If you haven't been there, you should check it out. It's really, really a cool place. Then the following week, we had a really great conversation with Bears new GM, Ryan Poles. And some of you who were there may have seen that I showed off my Bears socks and belt, which I try to do at every chance I get, so I was happy that I was able to do that. That was at another Chamber member organization at the House of Blues, and it was a really, really terrific event. So we're going to keep those kinds of events going and keep you as our members engaged in helping us move Chicago and the economy forward. But the spirit of excitement that I just described in terms of the last two events, it's really a credit to Jack Lavin and the Chamber team, and I'd like to thank them for their incredible work in pushing the envelope on our programming, our advocacy, and networking events. Let's give them a round of applause. Next, and perhaps most importantly, I'd like to thank you all, our chamber members, for your commitment to the chamber and its mission. And let's talk about the mission. The mission to advance the economy of our region and support a healthy and thriving Chicago for all. Who wouldn't sign up for that? The work that we've been able to accomplish together is truly remarkable, and I look forward to working with you all to help advance our city's economic outlook. It's really important. As we look to the future, the year ahead will be filled with both challenges and opportunities, to say the least. Elections at the city, county, and state level mean a period of undeniable flux that we must all navigate together. But we at the Chamber will stand ready to guide the region forward and enable a future-focused economy that will deliver on the promise that I talked about a minute ago, opportunity for all Chicagoans and a thriving economy. So I'd like to thank you very, very much for being here. And now I'm going to transition to our next speaker, and I'd like to welcome to the stage the nominating committee report, who will be read by Kevin Johnson, North American Chief Operating Officer at Aon and secretary and colleague of mine at the chamber. Welcome, Kevin.
Thank you, Kevin. And now for the nominating committee report. And thank you very much. We have a few orders of business to get through. First, the minutes from the Chicagoland Chamber of Commerce Board of Directors spring meeting. They were distributed to you in advance and approved via email, and I'd like to thank you for that. Now it is my honor to present the Board of Director nominees. We have a terrific slate of individuals who join us from some of Chicagoland's top organizations. Through an early voting process via email, the board accepted the nominations. For election to the Board of Directors, Jonathan Chowansky, who is Director of State Public Affairs at UPS, Kenneth Christensen, Dean of the Armor College of Engineering at Illinois Institute of Technology. We have Stephen Johnson, who's Regional Vice President of Store Operations at Walgreens Company. We have Praj Shah, who's CEO of Creospan, and Scott Ziomek, Vice President of External Affairs at Northwestern Memorial Healthcare. Please join me in welcoming our newest group of board members to the chamber. They add a depth of knowledge, perspective, and experiences that will be invaluable to the Chicagoland Chamber of Commerce. Now, at this point, I'd like to welcome Eileen Mitchell, President of AT&T Illinois, to say a few words as today's presenting sponsor. Eileen?
Thank you, Kevin. At AT&T, we believe all Americans should be connected to the future. And that's why we made a $2 billion three-year commitment to help bridge the digital divide. As part of that plan, we're creating AT&T Connected Learning Centers to promote digital inclusion, digital literacy, and digital learning solutions. We're working to help today's students and their families succeed wherever they learn, at home, in the community, or in the classroom. Today, we've announced our first AT&T Connected Learning Center here in Chicago. Here's a glimpse of how that center is connecting students and their families on the city's west side.
High-speed internet is vital to the residents that we serve here in the community. You know, underserved areas, sometimes just doing homework is a challenge. You know, a year ago during the pandemic, we had 100 kids between our three buildings doing their e-learning with us because they couldn't do it at home. Marillac St. Vincent is a great place for this Connected Learning Center because here on the west side and the south side, for that matter, there's so many communities that need more resources.
One of the things that we learned through the pandemic was that broadband connectivity is critically important to every person in every community.
We're providing AT&T fiber, internet, and Wi-Fi, new Dell computers, and digital learning resources, as well as mentoring and tutoring from AT&T employees. Our goal is to have a dedicated education space for students and families to learn and work and find opportunity.
And we're right here in the heart of the West Side in East Garfield Park, so it's a perfect place. We draw from the surrounding five communities. So hundreds of kids every day coming through doing any number of different after-school activities, and they'll be using the connections through the state-of-the-art, highest speed possible internet connection here.
It's like it could help more kids and help the ones who really need it to improve.
It keeps us productive.
During the day, we're going to plan to use this space with seniors. We have seniors that come for digital literacy classes, how to just get on to the internet.
I'm a senior citizen, and now I can get on the internet and I can do things that I couldn't do when we didn't have the internet.
You learn so much on the computer. I didn't know you could do so much on the computer either. That helped me connect with different people, and I could connect with my family, my grandkids, my great-grandkids.
AT&T makes an incredible commitment to communities across the city. In the Believe Chicago program, they've invested not only here in East Garfield Park, but 18 other communities across the city.
It's just a blessing that we got the internet, and AT&T is here to help us.
Please welcome Scott Swanson, president of PNC Bank, former chair of the board at the chamber, and most importantly, longtime chamber supporter.
Well, thank you. And I also want to thank Eileen. We greatly appreciate both your and AT&T's ongoing support of the annual meeting, and you as a key member of the executive committee. PNC has been proud to serve as a member of the Board of Directors of the Chicagoland Chamber of Commerce for more than 23 years, very much recognizing its importance as the voice of business. The Chamber is our fiercest champion, not only within the halls of government, but within every neighborhood across the region. Over the years, the Chamber has been integral in advancing countless public-private partnerships, convening key players in the city, county, and state level to help to move our economy forward. And today, it's my distinct pleasure to welcome one of the Chamber's longstanding advocates and our 43rd governor of the state of Illinois, Governor J.B. Pritzker. Governor Pritzker has made it a priority to work with both Democrats and Republicans to accomplish one of the most ambitious and consequential legislative agendas in our state's history. During his first session, the governor passed a balanced budget, resulting in six increases in the state's bond credit rating, putting us on a path toward fiscal stability. As governor, he continues to support new business and economic development with a key focus on sectors like electric vehicles and data centers. Before becoming governor, he worked with the Chamber to found the Chicagoland Entrepreneurial Center, which is now known as 1871, the nonprofit incubator that has helped entrepreneurs create more than 11,000 jobs and more than 1,000 new companies. In fact, since its creation of 1871, Chicago has been named one of the top 10 technology startup hubs in the world and added a record number of startup businesses in 2021. On behalf of the entire Chicagoland Chamber of Commerce, I'd like to thank Governor Pritzker for his leadership in helping to guide our state with an eye toward fiscal stability, job creation, and equitable economic development. With that, please welcome to the stage Illinois Governor J.B. Pritzker. Governor Pritzker.
Wow. Thank you so much, Scott. Thank you for your leadership, for your business leadership, your civic leadership. I want to thank the Chicagoland Chamber and all the members that are here today for inviting me to join you today. It has been three long and challenging years since this annual meeting was last able to take place in person. Even without a pandemic, Illinois presented challenges. We had challenges that we needed to address, there's no doubt. And in fact, that's why I ran for governor in the first place. And in those 3 years, our state has proven its resilience. Bouncing back from a deadly global pandemic and embarking on an economic and fiscal transformation, one that has pulled the rug out from under the naysayers and pessimists who have built a career on bad-mouthing the state of Illinois. Look, I'm an optimist by nature, but even if you discount that, the facts are the facts. Since 2018, I've proposed and passed four balanced budgets in a row. For the first time in two decades, we've eliminated the state's bill backlog that had reached nearly $17 billion under my predecessor. In fact, our bills are being paid in under 2 weeks now. I've paid down virtually every bit of short-term debt, including nearly $1 billion in overdue group health insurance premiums, and making the College Illinois program solvent. The state's long-standing structural deficit is nearly gone. Our pension debt is lower than when I took office and is now 10% below its peak. I'm restoring the state's rainy day fund. In fact, we put $1 billion into it. That's the highest amount that it's ever had. And by the way, we did all that without the help of the federal money from the ARPA program. Under my predecessor, the credit rating agencies hit us with 8 credit downgrades. Now, for the first time in more than 20 years, we've earned credit upgrades. In fact, 6 of them, saving taxpayers hundreds of millions of dollars in interest. Our firmer fiscal footing has allowed us to help families respond to the current inflationary environment by delivering $1.8 billion in direct tax relief this year, including doubling the property tax rebate, freezing the gas tax, and eliminating the grocery tax. The average Illinois family will see hundreds of dollars in tax relief coming their way in just the next few months. And if we stay the course, we can do much, much more. Contrary to the story that the carnival barkers told throughout the last decade, our state is growing. Our GDP is growing and is outpacing GDP before the pandemic. Illinois remains a leader in attracting corporate relocations. So we're attracting large and mid-sized businesses. New business startups each year have grown by nearly 70% while I've been in office. Illinois now has the largest growth in small business creation among the largest states in the nation. That means that we're beating states like California and New York, Texas, and Florida. And let's not forget the U.S. Census Bureau just announced that after reevaluating the 2020 census, 14 states were undercounted. Illinois was one of them. So now Illinois is at its highest population in its history. Our state has an awful lot to brag about, and I want to take a moment to focus on how we got here, what investments we've made, and most importantly, how we keep this momentum going and growing. As governor, my number one job is to make Illinois the best state in the nation to live, work, and play. Let's start with the fundamentals. If your infrastructure is falling apart, you can't attract and grow families and businesses. That's why I was hell-bent on proposing and enacting a historic capital plan. And we did it. Rebuild Illinois is investing $45 billion to modernize our roads and our bridges, our airports, water and sanitation systems, and our schools. That's just the state's portion of infrastructure. There's about another $17 billion coming from the federal infrastructure bill, too. These are investments that keep our Illinois businesses thriving and attract businesses and families that are looking to relocate. If you want to build your new factory or bring your business to a state that has the best surface, rail, water, and air cargo distribution capabilities, come to Illinois, where we have the world's fastest growing cargo airport, where we are rebuilding nearly, we already have rebuilt nearly 4,000 miles of roads and 400 bridges, many more to come, where all seven major railroads converge, and where we're building a port at the busiest point in the country's inland waterways. And we've done all of that in just the last 3 years. CNBC named us number one in the nation for infrastructure. To succeed in growing our economy, we have to maintain and build a highly talented workforce. So we've invested and incentivized workforce development. Working with the Illinois Manufacturers Association, we enacted an apprenticeship tax credit for businesses of all types to train workers while they earn. We've made community college more affordable by increasing state scholarships by 50%. On the south side of Chicago at City Colleges, we opened the Aviation Institute of Maintenance, the nation's largest aircraft mechanic school. In Rockford, we invested in the Aviation Career Education Center at Rock Valley College, where jobs are waiting for graduates at AAR, the aircraft refurbishing company that's partnered with United Airlines. As the state and the nation move from fossil fuel to clean energy, we've opened two new advanced manufacturing institutes in Metro East and in Bloomington to train people for jobs in the electric vehicle manufacturing and energy storage spaces. Every graduate from those programs has a job opportunity waiting for them. On top of that, we've created Illinois Works, a program focused on equity and supporting underrepresented populations who lack opportunities, not talent. Our well-trained workforce is one of the things that I hear most often when I talk to companies that are considering moving to the state of Illinois. Okay, so we've covered modernizing our infrastructure and upskilling our workforce. We also need to attract businesses in the fastest growing industries. Sort of the old Wayne Gretzky line, skate to where the puck is going. Having spent a reasonable amount of time in my career in technology, this is for me anyway, perhaps the most exciting part of what's happening in Illinois' economy. Investing in and incentivizing areas of the economy that hold the greatest promise of jobs and business success frankly gets my blood going. So let me start with quantum. The sheer potential of quantum computing and quantum engineering to transform the way that so many sectors operate has been matched at only a few points in human history. This is the information revolution on steroids, and Illinois is fast becoming the nation's leading quantum hub, not just for research, but also for commercialization. 3 years ago, Illinois had the opportunity to win the competition for federal DOE grants to become the nation's quantum leader. With a $200 million investment from our state's infrastructure bill, we connected our flagship state research university, University of Illinois, with the University of Chicago, and we catalyzed success. In fact, no other state got more federal grant money than we did, because our public and private universities, along with state government and our tech organizations, have methodically put Illinois at the center of the action in the quantum race. Think about the jobs that will come to Illinois if we become the Silicon Valley of quantum. We are also aggressively working to build Illinois into a highly competitive hub for electric vehicles. Last fall, I introduced and signed into law tax incentives specifically geared toward attracting electric vehicle manufacturers and suppliers through the REV Illinois Act. Our incentives are among the most competitive in the nation. Lion Electric just opened their first U.S. assembly plant in Joliet just last month. Rivian has nearly doubled its workforce. We're in discussions with major battery manufacturers and suppliers, and Illinois is now in the game for new EV businesses and jobs. In 2019, I worked with the Illinois Chamber of Commerce to pass and enact tax exemptions and credits to attract data centers to our state. And that's already brought more than $8 billion in new investments and created thousands of construction jobs and hundreds of IT jobs. In fact, Facebook recently announced a major expansion of their site in DeKalb. Our aggressive approach to business development is well complemented by our aggressive investment in attracting entrepreneurs to build new businesses. It's not an accident that we are growing new startups at a faster pace than other big states. It's because we've invested $500 million in Discovery Partners Institute in Chicago and in the 15 Illinois Innovation Network hubs across our state. We've restored the small business development centers that were closed under my predecessor. Our infrastructure bill has allowed us to invest billions in upgrading facilities at our major universities, in fact, even at our smaller universities, hundreds of millions of dollars for modern workforce development like advanced manufacturing and new grants for our national laboratories, all fueling the next generation of economic vitality for communities across our state. In fact, in just a few minutes, I know that the Chamber will debut the Chicago Tech Effect, its comprehensive study of the region's technology ecosystem. The findings are as clear as they are impressive, and I'm committed to remaining a strong partner in that progress. I won't pretend that it hasn't been challenging to be an optimist during this deadly global pandemic. Illinois already had hurdles to leap over, and that didn't make it any easier. And we continue to need to address our challenges. Crime remains a vexing one, which is why I made major increases in the ranks of our Illinois State Police, built state-of-the-art crime labs, reduced the DNA evidence backlog, initiated the Gang Crime Witness Protection Program, and doubled patrols and put hundreds of cameras on our expressways to deter shootings and to catch the perpetrators. But I've never been more resolute in my belief that Illinois is the best state in the nation with the greatest potential. I'm very proud of the work that our business community has done in partnering with state government in that endeavor. I want to thank you all for being a part of the Chicagoland Chamber of Commerce, for your commitment to the civic life of Chicago and Illinois, and thank you for having me here.